हेलो फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम टू द फाइनाइट एलिमेंट लेक्चर सीरीज। टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू सी सम ऑफ द बेसिक्स ऑफ फाइनाइट एलिमेंट एनालिसिस एंड व्हाट आर द एडवांटेजेस, लिमिटेशंस एंड सम ऑफ द एप्लीकेशंस ऑफ फाइनाइट एलिमेंट एनालिसिस। सो फर्स्ट लेट अस ट्राई टू डिफाइन व्हाट इज बेसिकली ए फाइनाइट एलिमेंट मेथड। So the finite element method, in short it is also called as FEM, is a computer aided mathematical or numerical technique for obtaining approximate numerical solutions to the abstract equations of calculus that predict the response of physical systems subjected to external influences. So the definition is quite simple. Okay, it is another method to calculate the response of physical system. So let's say I have a beam who is being subjected with, let's say, some axial force. How the beam will react to the applied force? Okay, if we want to find that, then the classical method would give us various formulas, okay, by deriving which we will be able to tell what is the deflection at certain points. But let us say if we want to find out the deflection of the entire beam as a whole, then perhaps we will have to use formulae for a very large number of times to find out the entire deflection of beam. Okay, the classical method allows us to find deflection at specific point, but the use of finite element will help us to derive the deflection of the same beam, okay, at any point. And this method uses the numerical technique. Okay, so we divide the entire beam into smaller parts, okay, we call them elements, and then we apply property on one such element, and then we integrate all set of elements. So that is basically what we do in finite element method. Okay, we will see the procedure of finite elements in detail shortly. The main aim of this method is to provide an alternative method which is based on mathematical or numerical techniques, okay, to find out the solution, okay, which can aid to the classical method. And we always have a requirement to verify the results. Okay, so one way is to formulate the scheme or formulate the solution using available classical methods. Okay, the other means is to test the results, okay, by some other technique. So the other technique, we can use this finite element technique. Okay, then also we can use the experimentation. Okay, so if we are doing these three forms, okay, then we can confirmly say that the results which we are predicting using our classical method are verified by experimental results and also finite elements. So finite element analysis gives us a completely different approach to arrive at a similar solution. We arrive at a similar solution and we use computer software, we use various algorithms which are developed, okay, and then we arrive at a required solution. So that is what the finite element method is. Now let us look at the brief history. So the matrix theory of structural analysis first began appearing in technical literature in the early 1940s. So the technique finite element analysis or finite element methods are basically numerical methods. Okay, so they based on matrix algebra. So once we formulate the equations, we tend to convert them into matrix equations, and then those matrix equations are solved inside the solver, computer solver. The term finite element was coined by Clough in a paper describing technique used for plane stress analysis in the 1960s at American Society of Computer Engineering conference on electronic computation. So around 1960, this finite element term was established or introduced first to the world. Large general purpose finite element programs began to appear in 1970s, including Nastran and ANSYS solvers. So these Nastran, ANSYS, okay, these are technological giants in current era. Okay, they began their journey once the finite element was somewhat established, let's say 5 to 10 years down the line. Okay, then they picked up the development and developed some large general purpose finite element programs. Okay, so they converted these techniques, which were paper based techniques during 1960 decade, okay, into a computer based technique. Okay, and they used softwares like C++, C, whatever, then Fortran, okay, whatever languages were used during that era. Then came finite element graphical pre and post processing methods in 1980s. Okay, slowly as the graphical memory, okay, and graphical devices started appearing, okay, then there was a need to represent everything graphically on a computer screen. Okay, so that became necessity around 1980s, and this made the construction of finite element models much less prone to human error. So the thing is, everything started becoming computer based, okay, and everything was started getting covered in your computer program. Okay, so be it the graphical output, okay, graphical display of the model, okay, everything slowly started becoming computer based, and that allowed error to creep away from the solution. Because everything, if it is getting calculated using a computer program, okay, then there are no human errors appearing. Then in the 1990s, automatic meshing became a standard feature for graphical preprocessors. So 1990 era, when automatic meshing, okay, so earlier you have to manually do the meshing, give the meshing parameters. Okay, we will see meshing in details, by the way. Meshing is a activity of dividing your domain into smaller elements or finite elements. Okay, and that is how the name of the subject basically has come up. So finite elements, finite is anything, any number which we can calculate. Okay, so if I have a large domain, okay, domain is area of interest. Okay, so let's say if I am saying the cantilever beam, okay, I have to apply axial force to the cantilever beam and study the deflection behavior of the cantilever beam. Then or rod, okay, if I am applying a cantilever beam with a point load, okay, in the downward direction, and if I want to study the deflection behavior, then the cantilever beam will become my area of domain, okay, area of interest or domain. So I will divide this particular beam into finite number of parts or elements, okay, which I can calculate. Now if I am doing this manually, okay, I will restrict it to some low number, let's say 10 elements, okay, or for that matter I can have say 12 elements, 15 elements, okay, but as I go on increasing the number, okay, in manual calculation, okay, it becomes very difficult for me to do the matrix algebra and calculations. So if I am using a computer program, okay, then I have no limitation as such, okay, no limitation as such. So the meshing, if it is getting done with the help of computer, okay, then there will be some schemes decided, okay, and those schemes were decided during the 1990s. So the schemes may cover, let's say, automatic meshing with a uniform mesh, okay, automatic meshing with non-uniform mesh, okay, then if it is a non-uniform mesh, then in what order the non-uniformity will be described. Say if you have a geometry change appearing in your model, okay, then in what aspect the geometry change will be covered. So all these things were included in the automatic meshing schemes around 1990s, and till that time those schemes are ever evolving. And now if you see, okay, we have very excellent automatic meshing schemes available in all the softwares, and they provide us with required results, okay, required results, and they also take less time to do the meshing, and the meshing is also becoming accurate. So that is all about the automatic meshing in the 1990s. And automatic meshing technology has matured, okay, in the current era, becoming better and faster. And finite element models continue to grow in size, requiring greater computing and analysis capabilities. So this is all about the brief history. I will take the example. Okay, we'll take one example of approximation of the perimeter of a circle. Okay, this example I'm quoting from the famous book by Dr. Jain Reddy, okay, on the finite element analysis. Okay, let us pretend, okay, that we don't know the formula for the perimeter of the circle, which goes perimeter P, okay, equal to 2 into 2 times pi multiplied by r, okay, where P is the perimeter of the circle. Okay, this P is the perimeter of the circle, and this r is the radius of the circle. Pi is a constant. Okay, let us say we don't know this formula, and still we want to find out the perimeter of the circle. So we approximate the value of perimeter of circle by approximating it by straight line segments whose lengths we can measure. So let's say I draw a circle. Okay, I draw a circle. Okay, I don't know the radius. Okay, I don't know the radius. Okay, and one rule is you can't measure the radius with the scale. Okay, but you have to find the perimeter of the formula. Okay, so how you will do? The one available way is, what I will do is I will divide that circle into smaller line segments, okay, whose lengths I can measure. Okay, whose lengths I can measure, and then I will measure the length and add up those lengths, and that will give me perimeter of circle. Of course, this perimeter of circle will be having error involved. Okay, the value that we will calculate will be less than the actual perimeter of circle. Okay, actual perimeter of circle. But if I extend, let's say, okay, I may use less number of lines, but if I say that, okay, my line segments will become smaller and smaller, okay, then my perimeter value will become will go close towards the actual value. Okay, so approximate value of perimeter is then obtained by summing the lengths of line segments used to represent it. Okay, now why we are doing this? We are doing this just to understand what exactly is happening inside the finite element analysis. Okay, how FEA approaches any problem. So that is what we are trying to understand. So we are trying to identify the perimeter of circle. Okay, and we will not be using the formula which is already in existence, which is 2 pi r. Okay, but eventually we will arrive at this formula, okay, without actually using it. So and since we are not going to use the perimeter formula, perimeter of circle formula, okay, we will not be using the radius of circle as well. Okay, so without these two things, we will be trying to identify the perimeter of circle. So as I was saying, this is the radius of the circle. Okay, now if I have to find the perimeter of circle, okay, I cannot use the 2 pi r formula. So one way of doing this is, okay, let us divide this into, say, 5 line segments of equal size. Now why equal size will help? Because equal size if I measure, let's say, one line segment, okay, and multiply it with the number of line segments that I have, okay, my measuring job becomes very easy. Okay, so that is why equal line segments. Otherwise I can have, let's say, likewise 10 to 15 line segments of unequal size, but then I will have to measure them separately, individually. Okay, individually. So here we are talking about the uniform mesh and non-uniform mesh. So here I have, say, larger number of line segments. Okay, now measuring, let's say, 100 line segments, so 100 times I will have to measure. Okay, and measuring 5 line segments, okay, is very convenient. Now if I have to measure 100 line segments of different lengths, then it's a tedious task. Okay, but if I can measure 100 line segments of same length, then my measuring job is very easy. I just have to measure once and then only count how many line segments I have and multiply the length by that count number. Okay, so doing this, okay, what I am doing, I am converting this circle into set of line segments. Okay, set of line segments. So this is what we call as the discretization of domain. Okay, this is what we call as discretization of domain. Okay, now for the simplicity and deriving some set of formulae, we will say the circle is converted into line segments in this manner. So I have 5 line segments. Now we'll select one such line segment having line length as HE. Okay, the arc which is subtended by that line segment, which is behind, okay, is having arc length equal to SE. Okay, now the angle which is subtended by this line segment with the center of circle is theta E. Okay, and we already know the radius of circle as R. Okay, remember, we are not going to use the value of radius. Okay, we are not going to use the value of radius. Otherwise, we will say we are using radius, but we are just using the variable of radius. Okay, so we are not using the value of radius. At this point of time, we want to derive some formulae, okay, and ultimately reach the same formula which we know for the perimeter of circle. So one step is, just I told you, okay, this particular dividing the circle into smaller line segments is called as discretization. So this is called as finite element discretization. Okay, first the domain is represented as n number of line segments, okay, in that figure B. Okay, so these are any number of line segments. Okay, so n number of line segments, which are called as discretization of domain. So the process is called as discretization of domain. Each subdomain is called as element. Now if I say this circle is my domain, okay, now after discretization, okay, I have n number of subdomains, okay, these smaller line segments, n number of subdomains, okay, and each subdomain is called as element. Okay, each subdomain is called as element. So basically I have n elements right now. Now collection of elements is called as finite element mesh. Now together it is called as finite element mesh. Now elements are connected to each other at nodes. Okay, now each element is connected with each other at points, okay, which are called as nodes. In current case, we discretize perimeter to mesh of 5 line segments of same length, that is uniform mesh, as we just talked about. Of different length, it is called as non-uniform mesh. So right now we are discretizing the circle into 5 line segments of same length. So it is uniform length. Okay, this is the uniform length, and we will go ahead with this condition and derive certain formulas without using the perimeter formula. Now element equations. A typical element is isolated and its properties such that length is calculated by approximate means. Now we want to calculate the length. Remember, we can't measure the length. Okay, that has no mathematical background. सकते हैं, मेजरिंग बिकम्स एन एंटायरली ह्यूमन एक्टिविटी विच इज प्रोन टू एरर्स. सो वी हैव सेपरेटेड और आइसोलेटेड द लाइन सेगमेंट, वन सच लाइन सेगमेंट, एंड नाउ वी विल मेजर द लेंथ ऑफ दैट लाइन सेगमेंट्स विद द हेल्प ऑफ सम अप्रोक्सीमेट मीन्स और सम फॉर्मूलेज. सो टिपिकल एलिमेंट लेंथ, ओके, बेस्ड ऑन द कंस्ट्रक्शन, ज्योमेट्रिकल कंस्ट्रक्शन विच वी हैव जस्ट मेड, ओके, द एलिमेंट लेंथ एच ई कैन बी टर्म्ड एज टू टाइम्स द रेडियस इन टू साइन ऑफ थीटा ई बाय टू. ओके, साइन ऑफ थीटा ई बाय टू. नाउ फ्रॉम वेयर इट इज कमिंग, ओके, इट इज वेरी इजी. ओके, इफ आई जस्ट पुट ए परपेंडिकुलर बायसेक्टर, ओके, एंगल बायसेक्टर ऑन दिस पर्टिकुलर लाइन एच ई, ओके, इट विल डिवाइड दिस ट्राइंगल इन टू टू इक्वल ट्राइंगल्स. ओके, टू इक्वल ट्राइंगल्स, द एंगल विल बी थीटा ई बाय टू, द एंगल विल बी थीटा ई बाय टू. ओके, नाउ इफ आई ट्राई टू फाइंड आउट द साइन ऑफ दिस थीटा ई बाय टू, देन इट विल बी एच ई बाय टू डिवाइडेड बाय आर, देन इट विल बी वॉट, एच ई बाय टू डिवाइडेड बाय आर. सो इन अदर वर्ड्स वॉट वी वॉन्ट टू फाइंड आउट, वी वॉन्ट टू फाइंड आउट द एच ई, सो वी विल टेक एवरीथिंग ऑन द अपोजिट साइड. सो एच ई विल बी इक्वल टू टू टाइम्स इन टू आर इन टू साइन थीटा ई बाय टू. सो दैट इज वॉट वी हैव रिटन ओवर हियर, टू टाइम्स आर इन टू साइन थीटा ई बाय टू. नाउ वेयर आर इज रेडियस ऑफ सर्कल, थीटा ई इज लेस देन पाई, is the angle subtended by line segment, it is always going to be less than pi, okay, because it is the angle subtended by that line segment. It can be further smaller and smaller if we go on decreasing the lengths of lines. Okay, now right now we have taken 5 line segments. If we take 500 line segments, okay, this angle is going to be further smaller. Okay, the third is assembly of element equations. Now, approximate value of perimeter is obtained by assembly of element properties in meaningful way. Okay, now this is the one line segment which we calculated, which is equal to what? HE is equal to 2 times radius times sine theta E by 2, where theta is the angle subtended by the line segment HE with the center of circle. Okay, and HE is the length of that line segment itself. Okay, so total perimeter, if we want to find out, okay, what we have to do, we have to add it that many number of times. Okay, now right now we have 5 such line segments of equal lengths, so we will add it 5 times. Okay, now imagine we have n such line segments. Okay, then we will just take a summation. Okay, so sum of the lengths of the individual elements, so those are called as P of n. Okay, which is equal to summation, so element 1 to n. So the summation will begin from 1 till n number of elements, and what it will add? It will add all those lengths. Okay, if mesh is uniform, then theta e is 2 pi by n. Okay, now if I have uniform mesh, okay, I have uniform mesh, so every time I calculate he, my theta is going to remain same. Okay, my theta is going to remain same. So this is just a angle which can be found out based on the entire 360 degrees of the circle. Okay, entire 360 degrees of the circle, and dividing it by the total number of line segments which we are using. So here also, if I try to calculate, let's say, what would be the angle. So like right now I have 5 line segments, so n is equal to 5, 2 pi is basically see, pi is 180, so 2 pi is 360, so total 360 divided by 5, okay, that will give us the value of the angle. Okay, value of the angle when we are going ahead with 5 line segments. Okay, see, identifying the value is not important over here. Identifying the value is not important over here. Okay, identifying the relation between the angle subtended by line with the center of circle and the total line segments that we have. is what we are looking for. So the total 360 degrees, the circle, okay, the center of circle, okay, how we draw circle, we revolve with the help of compass, okay, we do a entire 360 degree rotation. So the total degree is subtended by, let's say, circle, okay, is total 360 degrees. So all the four quadrants, you can say, so total 360 degrees. So in radians it is called as 2 pi, and divided by how many line segments we want to convert the circle into. So this is going to be the relation, which is valid relation. Okay, you have any number of line segments, provided all those line segments are equal. Okay, provided all those line segments are equal in length, then only this formula is going to work. Okay, if every line segment is of different length, this formula doesn't hold. Okay, this formula doesn't hold. So, okay, if we replace, let's say, if we replace theta e by 2 pi by n, okay, into this formula. So the previous formula is this. So theta e we are going to replace by 2 pi by n. So this 2 and 2 will get cancelled. We will have only sine pi by n. Okay, sine pi by n. So that's what we have over here. So 2r sine pi by n, and that n will go on the outer side, because when we take the summation, okay, number of element term will come outside, okay, and then we will have inside whatever is remaining. So this is by solving the summation, eventually we get this. So n multiplied by whatever is common, uncommon remaining inside. Okay, so convergence and error estimation. So what is error basically over here? So now when we formulated the problem, okay, we know that the arc length is going to be larger than the length of the line. Now in order to address this, okay, there is an error involved. So arc length minus the line length is going to be the error present in the solution. How I can minimize this value of error? If I go on decreasing the line length, okay, smaller and smaller and smaller, okay, till that particular point where SE and HE are becoming equal, okay, at that time this error will become zero. Okay, but mathematically speaking, okay, this error will never become zero in this particular case. Okay, because however small your line segment is, okay, it will always have some subtended arc behind it. Okay, so there will be always some amount of error present in the solution. Okay, so AC is length of the sector, which is also given by r theta. Now error for element in mesh is given by EE. So what we are doing, 2 pi by n minus 2 sine pi by n. Okay, r we have just separated. Okay, r we have just separated using this formula we are going. So r multiplied by theta. So for a full circle, so theta is what, 2 pi by n. So r into 2 pi by n minus this HE, we have r into sine pi by n. Okay, r into sine pi by n. Okay, so we have retained these two things. Okay, so SE minus HE. Okay, r is getting common. So the total global error is given by n into E. Okay, so n into the total error, number of elements into the total error. So 2r multiplied by pi minus n sine pi by n. Okay, pi minus n sine pi by n. Remember, we had n over here, okay, for the entire circle considered. So if you multiply 2 pi r minus pn, okay, 2 pi r minus pn. Now 2 pi r is perimeter of circle, minus pn is what we are finding the perimeter of n line segments. Okay, perimeter of n line segments, or perimeter of circle using n line segments, you can say, you can put it like that. So the error E tends to zero as number of elements tends to infinity, letting x equal to, okay, so how we can get rid of the error, okay, if I increase the number of elements. Okay, that is what we just talked about over here. Now I'll just use x equal to 1 by n, okay, x equal to 1 by n to get rid of this sin term. So p of n is 2r sin pi by n, okay, so x is 1 by n, okay, so pi x, okay, sin pi x, that is what I will get, okay, that is what I will get. So it basically turns into 2r sin pi x by x. Okay, and when I am going to apply limit to this formula, because as I have to reach to a certain value, okay, I have no other way but to use limits, okay, but to use limits. So limit n tends to infinity, p of n is given by limit n tends to infinity 2r sin pi x by x, okay, sin pi x by x is equal to basically limit n tends to infinity. Now I have the formula, okay, limit n tends to infinity sin pi x by x is called as cos pi x. Okay, so I will use that formula and a constant comes out. Okay, and a constant comes out. So that constant is basically pi. Okay, that constant is basically pi. So that comes out. So I have 2 pi r cos pi x by 1. Okay, now limit n tends to infinity cos pi x by 1 is basically unity. So it's a constant. And I have a constant term which is coming out of the limit sign. So this, there is no limit applied here. Okay, so it comes out, and 2 pi r, that's what I get. Okay, 2 pi r, that's what I get. Now I have kept that this divided by x, because we want to eventually solve the limit. Okay, eventually solve the limit. So this n will be effectively taken into x, okay, in this relation. So limit n tends to infinity, so 1 upon infinity, okay, 1 upon infinity is basically is basically infinity again. So that is how the limit is taken. So effectively, if we solve this limit, we eventually arrive at same formula, that is 2 pi r, okay, 2 pi r. So trying to identify the what we did in this particular problem is we have taken a known problem, okay, and we decided not to use the known relation, but effectively we arrived at the same relation. Okay, effectively we arrived at the same relation. So the procedure is working. Okay, procedure is working. So this is an alternate method to calculate the perimeter of circle. And eventually we arrive at the same relation again, okay, same relation again, and that is what we do in all the finite element problems. Okay, so the next thing is we'll try to understand, okay, whatever we have seen so far. Okay, we'll try to understand what exactly is FEM procedure. So in most simple terms, the basic steps involved in finite element methods can be described as, so first what we did was discretizing the domain. So discretize the entire geometry or domain into finite size approximate elements, which are also called as subdomains, interconnected at points called as nodes. Okay, the second is the number the elements and nodes appropriately. Step 3 is take a very general element which will represent all the other elements of the domain. Apply the differential equation to this representative element in the most general or local conditions. Using some numerical methods or techniques, get a general element matrix equation for it. In step 4, apply this element matrix equation to every element of the domain. Okay, so in our condition, we got element equation for one such line segment, and then we did summation. So that is what applying the now in our case, applying was actually not necessary because every line segment will have same length that we found. So assembly is what I am talking. So assemble approximately, So assembly is what I am talking as summation. So all such element matrices, to get a global or structural matrix equation for the entire domain, substitute the given global boundary conditions and initial conditions. Use matrix methods to solve the structural matrix equation to get primary variables or unknowns at nodes. Find the primary variable at any point in the domain other than the nodes. Find secondary variables or any other relevant derived terms from the primary variables, and represent the solution in tabular form, graphical form, or color code form. Okay, so all these steps are basically covered in three broad steps. So step 1 and step 2 is covered as, or is called as, pre-processing stage. Okay, step number 3 to step number 7 is called as processing stage. And once the results are processed, okay, we are trying to view the results in various forms. So that is called as post-processing stage. So step number 8 and step number 9. So whenever we call finite element method or finite element analysis procedure, okay, we broadly use these three broad steps: pre-processing, processing, and post-processing. Okay, which in turn involve all these detailed steps. Now let us look at some of the variables. Okay, let us look at some of the variables. So we have primary variable and secondary variable. So primary variables are direct variables, okay, whereas secondary variables are indirect variables, okay, as they are derived from primary. So primary variables are dependent variables. So differential equation contains dependent variables, and more accurate than secondary variables. Say, take an example, y equal to f of x. So y is dependent variable, okay, it is primary variable, which is called as displacement. Okay, now secondary variable is indirect variable, and it is any differential form of primary variable basically. So it is a derived one, and that is why it is called as secondary variable. Okay, don't worry, this is just an introduction thing. So of course, these variables, the boundary conditions, all these things will be seeing in much detail when we actually try to solve some of the problems using these techniques. Okay, so there are basically essential or Dirichlet boundary conditions, which contains primary variables, and all boundary conditions are of primary variables. So let's say I have some displacement at x equal to 0, okay, is known. Displacement at x equal to L is known. Let's say if it's a simply supported beam, okay, simply supported beam, or a fixed type of beam. So displacement at the left end of the beam, that is x equal to 0, is 0. Displacement at right end of the beam, x equal to L, is also 0. Okay, this is what we call as Dirichlet boundary condition or essential boundary condition. Then there is natural or Neumann boundary condition, which contains only secondary variables. So let's say the slope at these locations is known to us. So if I differentiate the primary variable of displacement, I will get slope. Okay, if slope is known, I will use slope boundary condition. Okay, if I differentiate it two times, okay, I will be knowing the bending moment. Okay, so let's say if that is known, okay, then perhaps we can use that. So only using some differential form of primary variables, okay, into your boundary condition is what we call as the Neumann boundary condition. Then there could be some mixed boundary conditions, so which may contain primary variables and secondary variables. So that is the third condition of mixed boundary conditions. So these are various boundary conditions which we have just seen: essential, natural, homogeneous, non-homogeneous, Dirichlet, Neumann, and mixed. Now what are the types of problems handled by FEM? So basically it can handle all types of problems, starting from equilibrium problems. These are also called as static or steady state problems. So 1, 2, or 3 dimensional steady state heat conduction problems with or without heat generation, fins, steady state nuclear fission in spherical or cylindrical shell, axially loaded bars, beams, trusses, frames, steady state laminar fluid flow, and steady state groundwater flow. So it basically covers all these problems. Eigenvalue problems. These are steady state problems where critical value of certain parameters are required to be obtained. So natural frequencies in vibrations. Okay. You can find natural frequencies of structures as well. Okay. Then propagation problem. These are called as unsteady state or dynamic or time dependent problems. So unsteady state heat transfer. Then periodically loaded mechanics problems, etc. Okay, FEM can handle the problems of all the types mentioned above. Now we'll try to see various applications. Okay, so we know by now, by looking at the types of problems FEM can handle. Okay, basically it covers all the physical aspects. Okay, so wherever I can apply physics, okay, I can apply FEM. So fields we have, then primary unknowns and secondary unknowns. So this list is very extensive list, and it is very important list in order to try and attempt to come up with some finite element equations later in this lecture series. So field is structural field, static and dynamic analysis. Primary unknowns are deflections, slopes, or deflections and frequencies. And secondary unknowns could be stress, strain, energies and reactions, etc. Then in heat transfer, the primary unknown is temperature and secondary unknown is any other form of temperature. So let's say temperature gradients, heat fluxes, heat transfers from convection phases, etc. Then in fluid analysis, both static and hydrodynamic, pressure is the primary unknown, and velocity, discharge gradients, convection coefficient, etc. are the secondary unknowns. In nuclear engineering, temperature is the primary unknown, and temperature gradients and heat flow rates is the secondary unknown. Then in electric circuit analysis, the charge is primary unknown, and current, voltage, energy are the secondary unknowns. Now some of the typical cases people have attempted to solve, and saw a great resemblance. Okay, had it been done earlier, these disasters could have been stopped. So we have San Francisco Oakland Bay Bridge. Okay, before the 1989 Loma Prieta earthquake, okay, this bridge was looking like this, and after the earthquake this happened. So people started doing some analysis, okay, on this, why the bridge collapsed. Okay, so they basically came up with a finite element model to analyze the bridge under seismic loads. So the earthquake loading is taken as a seismic load. Okay, this study has been published by ADINA R&D. Okay, so it has been taken from there. And what they found was the bridge was broken at exactly similar location. Okay, and would have broken at exactly similar location, and that actually gave the importance of this analysis, and slowly the analysis started becoming the necessity of any structural designing problem. And nowadays the finite element analysis is done along with the design, okay, just to confirm whatever design parameters are found out are safe for any such kind of loads. Okay, any such kind of load, seismic load, earthquake loading, etc., etc. Now the other thing is crash analysis of Ford Windstar. So what is the load deformation relation, partial differential equations of continuum mechanics, and meshless methods, iterative methods, automatic error control. Now crash analysis basically every automobile, okay, has to go with this crash analysis test, okay, just to confirm the various parameters after the impact. So there are various kinds of crash tests that the vehicle goes under. So frontal impact, side impact, okay, rear impact, etc., etc. Okay, so all these things are done using finite element analysis. Okay, and they decide various parameters, and then one such vehicle they test and try to compare the results of finite elements with the actual crash test. okay, because crash tests are very expensive, but in order to get the your vehicle on the road, these tests are necessary. So there also finite element plays a very vital role. Then engine thermal analysis, you can find out basically how the heat is flowing, okay, when your pistons cylinder are in operation, okay, how effectively your engine block can handle this heat, and it is transferring the heat to some other form. So all those temperature distributions inside the engine block can be found out using the finite element methods. Also the electromagnetic analysis of packages, so say Maxwell partial differential equations are applied to some integrated chips, okay, ICs, and see how they are dissipating heat, okay, the ICs get heated up, okay, and how their heat analysis can be done, or electromagnetic analysis of the packages is also possible. So these are some of the broad areas, okay, there are many. So we'll come to the advantages of FEA. So it can model complex shape bodies quite easily, okay, handle several load conditions without difficulty, handle different kinds of boundary condition, as we have seen, model bodies composed of several different materials. Now in this particular applications, okay, we have seen several different areas, let's say seismic loads, okay, static analysis with seismic loads, then here it was crash analysis, something to do with dynamic analysis, then here it is thermal analysis, here it is electromagnetic analysis. So as you can see, it can work with various type of problem. So that is why it can handle different kinds of boundary conditions, model bodies composed of several different materials, discretize the bodies with combination of different elements, that is also possible, vary the size of elements to make it possible to use small elements wherever necessary, then handle non-linear behavior, as we have seen non-linear or plastic deformation processes, then handle steady and non-steady, compressible, incompressible, laminar, turbulent flow problems, then handle time dependent and time independent heat transfer problem. So basically it is applicable to all physics, okay, whatever we can derive, okay, so that is the main advantage of FEM. You use one technique which is applicable to almost all type of problems. There are certain limitations, okay, lack of engineering judgment can give rise to serious errors. So now this is from the software point of view, okay, a lack of basic knowledge of finite elements will consume more time and may lead to absurd answers. Wrong inputs fed to the computer may lead to totally wrong solutions. Poor choice of element types may lead to incorrect solutions and absurd results. Different effects like buckling of the material caused because of non-linearities cannot be automatically included in the solution. So there are certain aspects, okay, onto which there are still some research going on, okay. So those aspects may not be available right now, but they will be in near future. Inadequate number of elements will give rise to error, and on the other hand, large number of elements will require more time to process. So if you take the example of perimeter of circle, we went ahead with 5 line segments, but the value that we will find out using those 5 line segments will be a very low value as compared to the perimeter value itself, okay. But if we go with n elements, so we reduce the length of line and have included, let's say, 1000 lines, okay, then we will require more time to process. Now computer softwares are expensive, so all these finite element packages, let's say ANSYS, NASTRA and Abacus, okay, all these are very expensive softwares. Modeling the actual structure is difficult, time consuming and highly skilled process. Any error in this may generate serious errors in the analysis. So okay, before you can do discretization, you must have domain with you. So finite element domain creation is a challenging task, and for that matter you require a 3D modeling tools, okay. So that can be tiresome, that can be challenging, and post processing and error analysis requires tremendous engineering knowledge. Okay, so if you have solved the results, okay, come up with results, okay, how you are going to display those results in various forms. Okay, for that also you require good amount of understanding of the physics that is happening. So all in all, this is the introduction to finite elements. We have seen one classical problem of finding the perimeter of circle without using the perimeter formula, and we have also saw various applications of finite elements, its advantages and disadvantages. So in next lecture we will actually come up with some techniques, okay, to solve some of the differential equations, okay, and those techniques are called as weighted residual methods, and we'll start solving some of the differential equations with the help of weighted residual methods from the next lecture onwards. So I hope you followed whatever was discussed over here, and stay tuned for more such interesting content on finite element analysis. Till then, thank you very much.